Tonight's a special occasion as we celebrate the publication of a very important collection of essays, speeches, and articles, 1968-2012, by His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales. This volume is edited by Professor Suheil Bushrui and Professor David Cadman under the sponsorship of the Gibran Chair. There are many ties between the mission of the Gibran Chair and the essays found in this volume. While Professor Cadman will discuss the important points of the writings by the Prince of Wales, let me spend a minute to explain the mission of the Gibran Chair. Cahil Gibran is the inspiration for Arab literature written in English during and after his time. He is one of the most important intellectual and literary contributions to the revitalization of Arab intellectual life in the beginning of the 20th century. The Gibran Chair is designed to address issues of justice and peace and encourage the study of cultural pluralism, human rights, and the role of the arts, poetry, and literature in promoting international communication and cooperation. These studies emphasize the enduring human values which Gibran advocates in his writing and which are essential for the creation of a world vision based on the principles of unity in diversity. Later on this evening, we'll listen to Professor Cadman's overview of the speeches and articles by His Royal Highness, and it will become even more apparent why Professor Bushrui, as Gibran Chair, and Professor Cadman were so compelled to bring these works to the greater public. However, before I proceed, I'd like to ask a few of our honored guests to say a few words. Dr. Kerwin is Chancellor of the University System of Maryland, which is comprised of 12 state institutions. Dr. Kerwin has supported the work of Dr. Bushrui throughout his tenure as chancellor, and while he was president of the University of Maryland from 1988 to 1998. Please join me in thanking Dr. Kerwin in joining us tonight.
Thank you very much. Some of you may know, I'm stepping down from my position as chancellor of the University System of Maryland after serving 51 years in higher education. I thought 51 years was a good round number. And as chancellor, I work with 12 very talented type A presidents, as you can imagine. So I can now retire with joy, because a president has deferred to me, finally. Believe me, that doesn't happen often. But I do want to thank everyone who's here this evening and the opportunity to say a few words. Unfortunately, I have a commitment in Baltimore, so I have to leave after my remarks. But when Suheil called me and asked if I would say a few words, I, of course, had to rearrange my schedule so I could at least be here to offer some thoughts about him and what he's meant to the university. And I think everyone in this room knows. When Suheil asks, you, of course, respond. It's amazing. I have the great honor of being the president of the university when we appointed Suheil Bushrui in 1992, as the first chair, Baha'i chair of world peace. Even at this very fine and sophisticated university with lots of highly educated people, of course, I have to say we were all dazzled by Suheil. His erudition, his eloquence, and of course, his remarkable scholarship. He has been in that position, stayed in that position for, I think, 13 years, and built a remarkable program as the Baha'i Chair for World Peace Studies. And I had the great good fortune to work closely with Suheil and Mary during those years. And I remember a couple of very important things in my life, and I think were important to the chair. we actually had Madame Rabbani visit the university, and she stayed at the president's house right on the hill here. And it was such an honor to have her in that house. I just, and what an unbelievably gracious person she was. And then we had a return visit. And she had, had the great good fortune to have dinner in her beautiful home right below the Baha'i Shrine and the fabulous garden, all because of Suheil. And so I owe so much to Suheil. And, you know, we have so many things that we share in common in terms of values and interests in scholarship. I, of course, I'm not a scholar of Gibran, but I've long been a great admirer of Gibran and read all of Suheil's books about Gibran. In fact, when my son got married, I read Gibran's poem on love at the wedding. That is a remarkable poem. If you haven't read it or if you've forgotten it, get it out and read it again. It is such a beautiful, beautiful poem. And I think the tribute to Suheil about the significance of his work is that when he did step down, we were able to recruit such a phenomenal person to come in and be the second Baha'i Chair for World Peace. So Hoda, we are all in debt to you for coming here to take this chair and move it yet further. Just one other comment I have to make about Suheil. We knew he was a great scholar. We knew he was a gifted expositor and raconteur and would help graduate students with theses and things like that. What we didn't realize is the impact he would have on undergraduate education. And Suheil took, I mean, he saw his responsibility as to working with these bright young students who were coming to the university. And he wrote this phenomenal book on the spiritual heritage of the human race. And he turned that book into an honors course. And a series of students came through the university and had the great good fortune to take that course with that book taught by Suheil Bushrui. Now, I happened to see some of the teacher evaluation forms from that course. And believe me, in 51 years, I've read a lot of teacher evaluation forms, some of my own, some of others. I have never read, ever, teacher evaluation forms like the ones written about Suheil. And so I just want to conclude with a little anecdote I shared the other day with Wallace. There was this president of Harvard, and he was once asked, why is Harvard such a great university? And he thought for a moment. He said, well, it's pretty simple. The freshmen bring so much to the institution, and the seniors take so little away. Now, I know for certain that with the great leadership of Wallace and Marianne Rankin, our wonderful provost, that our students are taking away a lot from this institution. But I can say with certainty that the students who were blessed to be in the honors course that Suheil taught took away something that will stay with them the rest of their life. And it's just been such a joy to have Suheil as my friend and colleague over all these years, my simple camel driver friend, I might add. He always introduces himself as that. So, Suheil, I just want to say that that as I look back on my time in higher education as being president of the University of Maryland, I'm very proud of things that happened during the time I was president. But right up there in the most prized things that happened was your appointment to this position. You have made such a difference in this university. But more than that, your personality, your intellect, your writings, your contact with so many people have made a phenomenal difference in so many lives. And we all thank you for that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Britt. And now for the president of the University of Maryland, Dr. Wallace Lowe.
Thank you very much, Paul. And Britt, thank you so much for coming and sharing your thoughts with us this evening. I thought your comments about Suheil were so deeply moving and touching. And thank you again. And I understand you do have to dash off to Baltimore. So everyone, welcome. Thank you for coming this evening. The completion of this very significant academic project is certainly a cause for celebration, especially when the scholars doing this project are so dear to all of us. And Suheil, I'm so happy that you're here this evening with us. And Dr. David Cadman, thank you so much for being with us as a visiting professor. We're honored to have you on our campus, and congratulations to both of you on the completion after several years of this work, that this archival record of the writings and the speeches of His Royal Highness. I want to take this time also to thank our hosts, our new Dean of the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences, Dr. Gregory Ball. Would you stand up for a moment? This is what, your first week or second week on the job?
First week.
First week, wow. May you be here for many hundreds of weeks. For the past 5 years or so, we have had a wonderful dean. He has served fabulously as the dean of the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences, and who has supported Suheil in his monumental work, Dr. John Townshend. Please stand up. And a very warm welcome to all the friends and supporters of the Gibran Chair. Thank you for your support that makes possible the work of the chair. Now, this book, which is published by the University of Wales Press, this archival collection of His Royal Highness's words, it has its genesis here, and it has its genesis in the work of Suheil. The only thing I could add to what Britt has already said is I have heard, I've only been here for 4 years, but there are students who talk about him, and I have heard about those students. And it's not just what I've heard from the students, it's not just about his erudition and his scholarship. And I've heard it also from somebody tonight. It's when one stands in the presence of Suheil, one senses the embodiment of spirituality and peace. He lives the values that he writes about. And that is what makes him such a beloved and respected person. And so his desire to translate the prince's words for an Arab audience, you know, it is a way of bridging East and West. His expertise in Yeats, in Gibran, and the literary heritage of the Arabs gives him that ability to bridge that cultural gap. He is, of course, an expert in Yeats, having translated Yeats's poetry into Arabic. And so I looked up Yeats, and I discovered this quotation, which I think is quite appropriate for the occasion. Yeats wrote, "Talent perceives differences, genius, unity." So Suheil and David's genius lies in the bridge that they have built with words to promote the unity that the times of today demand. Congratulations to both of you on your monumental scholarly accomplishment. Thank you all again for supporting the work of the Gibran Chair, and welcome to the University of Maryland.
Next, I would like to introduce Professor John Townshend. Dr. Townshend is a professor in geographical sciences at the University of Maryland. He was dean of the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences from 2009 until this past July. During his tenure as dean, he worked closely with the Gibran Chair, including the body of work on His Royal Highness's message. That collaboration culminated with Dr. Townshend's foreword to this volume of speeches and articles that we are celebrating today. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Townshend.
First of all, can I say that the plan was that you'd be able to eat while we were speaking, and since I'm well used to speaking to noisy groups of students, you chomping a little bit of salad is not going to worry me in the slightest, so you're feeling at all hungry, please do start. President Lowe, Provost Rankin, Dean Ball, distinguished guests and colleagues, it's really a great pleasure to have the opportunity to say just a few words at the launch of this collection of speeches. Value is a word more often heard these days in an economic context. One is referring to the value of stocks and shares, pensions, a topic increasingly close to my mind, or items on the Antiques Roadshow. But the values that determine how we live our lives, how we assess the value of nature, how we evaluate the quality of our built environment, are the subject of much less discourse and more the shame. Values are the heart of many religious faiths, but it is remarkable how many of the fundamental values are shared by so many different religions, and even by those who have no formal religious adherence, such as myself. The essays of His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales are in essence about the values he believes are important to present and future generations. They encompass the ethical, the programmatic, the spiritual and the practical, but the values are there for all to read. As the Prince in his speeches has developed his ideas, many found much to agree with, sometimes rather to their surprise. Others may disagree with his ideas and want to debate them or offer alternatives, but their clarity allows honest and vigorous debate. Revealing value in ideas in speeches and now in the written word has, to put it mildly, not been a traditional role of the heir to the British crown. In fact, quite the opposite almost. However, the Prince has used his role as heir apparent to bring together people holding very different views and representing very different constituencies. Although this is a book primarily about values, ideals, and beliefs, it also emphasizes practical solutions. These have been manifested, for example, through the many charities that the Prince has founded, and the hundreds of thousands, and I believe eventually millions of people, that his personal efforts will have benefited. There's much to enjoy in this volume, much to be challenged about, and much to engage national and international debates. All readers of this collection of speeches owe an enormous debt to the scholarship and industry of Professors Suheil, Bushrui and David Cadman. They were the first scholars fully to recognize the importance of assembling the Prince's speeches into a coherent collection. Now, in this much more comprehensive set of speeches, we're able to gain an even deeper appreciation of the Prince's ideas and the evolution of his thoughts on a wide variety of pressing contemporary issues. Finally, I would be remiss on this occasion if I did not acknowledge the debt of the University of Maryland to Dr. Bushrui, of which this volume is but the latest manifestation of his scholarship. He's a master teacher and a scholar of amazing breadth and depth. He has been responsible for the setting up of two peace chairs here at Maryland, and his legacy will be with us for the foreseeable future. He's also a very dear friend. Before asking you to acknowledge Dr. Bushrui,
I'd also like to recognize his wife.
Be hard to follow. At this point, I'd like to introduce Ms. Priya Krishnan. Ms. Krishnan is a research assistant to Professor Bushrui and is a senior pursuing a double degree in physiology and neurobiology and music violin performance. Her paper, The Art of Interbeing, received the 2014 Winston Family Best Honors Student Paper Award for the best research paper, for which her faculty mentor was Professor Bushrui. Ms. Krishnan will discuss a perspective on the message of His Royal Highness to the youth of the world.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shackle. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Before I begin speaking tonight, I would like to take this opportunity to offer my sincerest gratitude to Professor Bushrui. In the 1 year that I have been fortunate to know Professor, which is a very short span in the amount of time he's been teaching, he has become a very special mentor to me and like a grandfather. He is the reason I have the privilege to address you all here today. I am constantly in awe of his tireless work ethic and his steady guidance and constant inspiration. So thank you, Professor. Last fall, I had the unique opportunity to participate in an enriching and fulfilling course, the Spiritual Heritage of the Human Race Honors Seminar, taught by Professor Emeritus Suheil Bushrui and two co-instructors who are both here today, Mr. Michael Dravis and Dr. Sai Majidi. This course was not only intellectually challenging, but also emphasized the nurturing and cultivation of the spirit. In learning from the instructors, the guest speakers, and my fellow students, I was encouraged to become a more active listener, a more open-minded student, and a more respectful and empathetic global citizen. In particular, the speeches and essays of His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales, as presented in the course, left an everlasting impression on all the members of the class. It is with the utmost gratitude to His Royal Highness for his inspirational work that I am addressing you all today. He writes, "As I have grown older, I have gradually come to realize that my entire life so far has been motivated by a desire to heal the divisions between intuitive and rational thought, between mind, body, and soul, so that the temple of our humanity can once again be lit by a sacred flame. As a proponent of universal harmony, how appropriate his words are today, as humanity finds itself amid a globalized world teeming with interconnectedness and buzzing with discovery. The newest generation of young adults will soon take up the mantle of managing the troubles that plague the world. And by now, we can list them with frightening ease: global warming, human trafficking, poverty, war, and above all, a disturbing loss of spiritual priority. But it is not enough to assess and evaluate. We, the youth of the world, must creatively engineer sustainable solutions to these problems. And this, with foresight and poise, is precisely what His Royal Highness has done and continues to do with his life's work. His Royal Highness advocates for a values-based approach to achieving peaceful coexistence. True universal harmony will be characterized by a confluence of positive forces, both natural and man-made, and both scientific and spiritual. In classifying the present period as the Age of Disconnection, His Royal Highness highlights the unfortunate overemphasis placed by many academic institutions on mastering external phenomena, while core values of integrity and diligence, which should in truth dictate the manner in which students embark upon the journey of learning, are classified as non-essential traits, as ornamental, not vital. Awareness that education cannot be defined as mechanical acquisition of knowledge is not a novel idea. Aristotle, in his Nicomachean Ethics, famously states, "We are inquiring not in order to know what virtue is, but in order to become good, since otherwise our inquiry would have been of no use." A student cannot contribute to his or her community or to the world at large as a global citizen without possessing compassion and a multifaceted awareness of the experiences of those with disparate circumstances, and above all, a capability to recognize commonalities in the interconnected web of humanity. Globalization is often thought of and taught about as an outward, externally observable phenomenon. Thus, it is dehumanized and compartmentalized. But universal integration must not come at the cost of integrity. A few months ago, I had the opportunity to meet with a poet named Natalie Diaz, whose work explores themes of social justice. Presently, she is working with members of the last elders of the Mojave tribe to preserve their language for future generations. In a recent interview, she poignantly mentioned that the Mojave, who are deeply rooted in tradition, believe that spiritual messages come to them in dreams. The adults and elders of the tribe are worried that Mojave children are receiving important spiritual truths in dreams, but cannot make sense of them, and are consequently losing valuable opportunities to develop their spiritual identities. In a similar vein, His Royal Highness has eloquently written, "I happen to be concerned that there is a danger that we are creating a society in which children, wherever they come from, will have a diminishing chance to understand their place in history. We cannot allow inherently spiritual peoples, such as the Mojave, to sacrifice their values for a society which, at present, promotes feverish individual acquisition and a fast-paced lifestyle over collective welfare." Last year, during a Spiritual Heritage of the Human Race class session, Professor David Cadman delivered a lecture in which he addressed the disparities between our personal beliefs and the larger overarching systems that govern our lives. As an in-class exercise, we, the students, were asked to identify values that characterized our personal lives, the economy, and the government, respectively, and to list and group these values according to the category they described. The values that we attributed to the running of the government and the economy, power and greed, strongly contradicted those of our personal lives, love, selflessness, and truth. Professor Cadman eloquently commented, "We are being asked to accept an economy driven by selfish values in disjunction with personal values. Very few values overlap among the three categories. Neoclassical economics, which is meant to operate on the principle of justice, theoretically would result in markets effectively responding to the needs of the people efficiently. But this does not happen. So why does this discrepancy exist? Perhaps we as global citizens must take more responsibility for the workings of these larger entities. We must ensure that the government and the economy accurately reflect the sentiments close to our hearts. After all, as the Hadith mentions, a man's conduct is the measure of his faith. Many of the world's current political conflicts stem from clashes between religious groups. Hence, there is an immediate exigency for interfaith work. 20th century theologian Hans Küng has famously stated that there will be no peace among the nations without peace among the religions. His Royal Highness's interfaith work, embodied by the Temenos Academy, promotes unity in diversity and reiterates the timeless truths of the world's spiritual traditions, referred to by Aldous Huxley as the perennial philosophy. Central to His Royal Highness's work is a passion for sustainability and for the environment, since no discussion about sustainability can take place without taking into account humans' relationship with nature. Though the phenomenon of global climate change and its projected drastic effects are common knowledge, environmental issues and technological advancement are treated often as purely scientific issues. In his speeches, His Royal Highness laments the prioritization of rational inquiry over spirituality. Though spiritual knowledge may be widely available, the quality of that knowledge is decreasing. Ultimately, this polarization results in an uncomfortable clash between inner intuition and outer mechanistic action, which His Royal Highness has appropriately deemed the clash of minimalisms. In fact, the idea of empirical observation as the primary way to analyze one's environment gained popularity only relatively recently in the context of human history, during the 18th century Enlightenment. As a biologist in training with a passion for spirituality, I am interested in reintroducing the human empathetic side to the empirical sciences, and especially to medicine. Modern-day theoretical biologist and eco-philosopher Andreas Weber is a proponent of an alternate philosophy from the Enlightenment, that of enlivenment. Weber argues that the biggest obstacle to the vexing questions of sustainability, itself a very elastic term with multiple and conflicting meanings, is the fact that science, society, and politics have, for the last 200 years, lost their interest in understanding actual, lived, and felt human existence. To solve these problems, Weber calls for a reintroduction of the human element into science. His Royal Highness also believes that reintegrating human experience into scientific investigation is vital to making discoveries in medicine for the good of humankind, because our identities, whether physical or metaphysical, are so entangled with our experiences. And in fact, current scientific work is approaching the same conclusions apparent in the sacred writings of the world's ancient spiritual traditions. The Vedic thinkers concluded, and the modern-day Einsteins are beginning to posit, that underlying all the fluctuations of apparent duality is one unchanging ground of being. In his book, Harmony, His Royal Highness remarks on how many of the great architectural wonders of the world, designed as places of worship, are patterned after sacred spaces. A return to the spiritual traditions of the world is both practical and necessary, as it can help to re-establish reverence for the environment, especially since material creation is seen in many spiritual traditions as a medium for humanity's spiritual education and expression, and transgression against nature, therefore, is synonymous with transgression against the divine. The University of Maryland is currently pioneering several sustainable initiatives, such as offering options to compost food in dining facilities, raising awareness of ways to save energy, including riding bicycles and carpooling, and presenting opportunities to support local cultivators at a weekly farmers market. Earlier this year, the university received a STARS, Sustainability Tracking Assessment and Rating System, gold rating from the Association for the Advancement of Sustainability in Higher Education, ranking the university's sustainability efforts as one of the most successful in the nation. In the words of His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales, let us continue in earnest the work of sustainable development, ending a throwaway world by building a world that does not deserve to be thrown away. Reflecting upon the Baha'i Faith's concept of the maturation of humanity, I firmly believe that the afflictions currently experienced by the world have the capacity to be nurtured and healed. In the spirit of His Royal Highness's inspirational work to establish a harmonious world, I will leave you with a quote from the Sufi saint Al-Nuri. I looked one day at the light, and I did not cease looking at it until I became the light. Thank you.
Thank you, Priya. Now I'd like to introduce Professor David Cadman. Professor Cadman served as the chairman of the Prince of Wales Foundation. He represents His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales, on the Executive Committee of the Friends of Mount Athos and is a trustee of the Prince's School of Traditional Arts. He has had a number of professional chairs, and for many years he was a fellow of Wolson College, Cambridge. He's presently visiting professor at University College London and visiting professor at the University of Maryland. He has written and lectured extensively on the subject of urban land economy, and more recently his published work draws upon the teachings of the great spiritual traditions, especially those of Buddhism and Quakerism. He has authored many articles and books on the subject. In recent years, he has worked with Professor Bushrui to edit and publish the speeches and articles of His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales, which have now been published and are being presented this evening, and a copy is on everybody's chair. So, Professor Cadman.
I want to open my remarks with a number of thank yous. Although I am quite often to be found walking with a prince of the realm and sharing his supper table, I am seldom honored by a president, a chancellor, a former dean, a new dean, and a professor of a college. And I am grateful to you all for your graciously coming to this occasion, although I am not so foolish as to imagine that it was me that was the attraction, but rather, of course, my dear brother. I think that Professor Bushrui and I have been working together for some 20 years. It is impossible to remember how young we were then. And over this time, Suheil has become my brother, and it is a privilege for me to sometimes have been able to tether some of his camels. I worked with him when he held the Baha'i chair for world peace, and I have, for the last five or six so years, worked with him in his present position as the holder of the George and Lisa Zakhem Khalil Gibran Chair for Values and Peace. Without Suheil, and of course, without the vision and generosity of George and Lisa Zachem, none of our more recent work on the speeches of the Prince of Wales would have been undertaken, and nor would it have been completed. It is worth saying that the vision that George and Lisa Zachem hold, with its emphasis on values and peace, is also a vision held by His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales. And in working with the Prince over many years, and in studying his work, I have come to see that there is an emerging recognition of the importance of these matters throughout the world, a thirst for values and peace. And I have to say that it is enormously encouraging to hear our young person speaking with such depth and eloquence on these matters. And I see from my own work, not least my work with the Spirit of Humanity Forum, with its global community of practitioners, a coming together of people and disciplines in an urgent awareness of a coming crisis that connects society, economy, and environment. If we once thought that the sciences and the humanities were separate, if we once thought that only those things that can be numbered mattered, we are coming to see that this is not so. The social, the economic, and the environmental are inextricably intertwined. The measurable and the immeasurable are intertwined. And so it is that those special places where young people from different subjects, from sciences, the arts, and humanities can come together and find that they have things to say to each other and things to learn from each other. These places are of great importance, and the Gibran Chair and all that it stands for plays a vital role in this. I'm about to present this archive, the speeches and articles of the Prince of Wales, 1968-2012. This is a preview, as the archive will be launched formally in the UK in late November or early December. And at that time, a number of copies signed by the Prince of Wales will be sent to its main supporters here in America and there in the UK. And I want you all to know that His Royal Highness is deeply aware and grateful for the role that has been played in this publication by the university and by all those connected with the George and Lisa Zachem Halil Gibran Chair. Professor Bushrui and I believe that despite our evident frailties and inadequacies, this archive, which has never before been put together, will in time be an important historic record of the work and thoughts of His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales, something which we both hope this great university will be proud of. It is almost 10 years since Professor Bushrui and I began the task of selecting and compiling this collection at the request of the University of Maryland. We began with two shortish volumes, which were published in 2006 and 2009, both of which have been translated into Arabic by Professor Bushrui and published separately. And then about 3 years ago, the university asked us if we would update these volumes and bring them together in a single publication. And this we've done, and the result is this archive, which is to be launched later this year. In the beginning, we decided not only to update the text, but also to go back to the earliest speeches and follow them through to 2012. So this new archive starts with the first ever speech made by the Prince of Wales in 1968, when he was only 20 years old. And not surprisingly, it was on what we now refer to as the environment, although it was then simply the countryside. And a selection of these updated texts has also been translated by my dear brother and will be translated into Arabic, of course, and will be the subject of a separate publication. So what is it that this new archive contains? As I've said, it's a compilation of speeches and articles, and the texts are grouped together in eight parts, each of which represents one of the key areas of the prince and of his work for the period of 44 years. It begins with a part which is entitled Harmony, which, if you like, is the recurrent theme running through all the other parts of the archive, as it encapsulates the prince's underlying principle of balance and order in all that is when it is at its best, when it is most truly itself. This order, this harmony, represents, if you like, what the prince would call the sacred geometry of the cosmos. Each part of the archive is preceded by an editor's introduction, which tells the story of the texts. And in addition, there is at the beginning a main introduction expressing the overall characteristics of the archive. And before this, there's a foreword by His Royal Highness and two prefaces, one from Professor John Townshend here at Maryland, and the other from Professor Medwin Hughes, who is the Vice Chancellor of the University of Wales. And these two great universities came together to commission this work, which was a great delight, I have to say, to His Royal Highness. And at the end, there is a reflective epilogue, which closes the work. And to add grace to the volumes, each part is begun with a watercolor painted by the Prince of Wales, who is an accomplished landscape painter in watercolor. This is just one of them. What then is the story that this archive tells? This is what Professor Bushrui and I have said in our opening introduction. We said, this is a story about a young prince brought up with a deep sense of duty and the need to match words with action. This is a prince who in his teenage years becomes distressed by what he sees as a deliberate attempt not only to separate present from past, but to abandon the principles and meaning of a timeless tradition. In his own words, to throw out the baby with the bathwater. The tradition in question is not a longing for the past or crude sentimentality. It is a golden thread of wisdom that speaks of balance, order, and connection, and of a reverence for nature as a whole, something that is sacred. Therefore, it is a living tradition. And as you read these speeches and articles, I think you will have to come to the conclusion that although at times he has been mocked and criticized for speaking out, the prince has again and again spoken ahead of his time and been proved to be right. His warnings on deforestation, resource depletion, and climate change are but one example of this. And I'm sure you will also note that his words are always backed up with action. In this respect, I suppose his best known charitable initiative is the Prince's Trust. That's the one that people mainly know about. And the Prince's Trust helps disadvantaged young people get a start in life, finding someone who believes in their potential and helps them realize it. But each of his areas of work are expressed in practical initiatives. Indeed, in the year ending March 2014, the Prince's charities raised over $210 million to fund their work. And I know from my own experience of being a trustee of just one of those how much that $210 million depends upon the effort and the inspiration and the tireless energy of His Royal Highness. Not something that you read very often in the press when people write about the prince. His hard work, his dedication, his warmth, his concern, especially for those people whose voice is seldom heard. And a key feature of the prince's work is what he refers to as a crisis of perception. And in a sense, it's a radical proposition. He suggests that the difficulties that we face, the erosion of resources, climate change, extreme poverty, and even an unstable economy, arise not from technical glitches, but from what he has referred to as a crisis founded in the very values and principles that knowingly or not shape how we see, understand, and experience the world. This radical claim, he says, goes to the root of our present concern with economic, social, and environmental sustainability. No surprise that he often upsets people, particularly those people who would like things to remain as they are. And as we have already heard, the prince finds the root cause of this crisis to be an imbalance, a loss of harmony, brought about by the dogma of post-war modernism, which no doubt with good intent and with the aim of improving our material well-being, which it has, ignored the limits of nature, ignored the need to see ourselves as part of, not apart from, nature. Restoring balance, restoring harmony, healing our relationships with nature and with each other informs all the work of the Prince of Wales. And I'm going to say just a little bit about the parts of the archive. And the first one that I'm going to talk about is the one which I'm going to say most about, because I know it's important to many people. There are two parts in the archive that refer to what the prince has to say about the natural environment. The first is a part which is concerns with farming, forestry, and fisheries. And here the principle of harmony is expressed in terms of our relationship with nature. As early as 1977, 37 years ago, and before such things were, shall we say, fashionable, the prince was speaking of the art of balancing our use of land, something that he would later put into practice as he transformed the home farm at Highgrove along the lines of organic farming, or what he now refers to as ecosystem-based farming. During the 1980s, this concern began to reflect the growing evidence of mankind gradually, in some cases more rapidly, destroying Earth's living systems. And this was increasingly linked to worldwide concerns for sustainability. The coming together of a healthy environment, a healthy society, and a healthy economy. And in March 1988, still 26 years ago, the prince was speaking at the European Year of the Environment. And I'm quoting him here a little bit at length because this is such an important part of what he has to say. And this is such a vital topic for us to address at this moment of time. I have a house in Michigan which was hit by a tropical storm. I don't know whether the news spread to this part of the country, but we were hit by a tropical storm about 6 weeks ago, and I had 3 feet of foul sewage in my basement. We had 4 inches of rain in an hour. It hadn't happened for 90 years. I would put a considerable amount of money on the fact that it will happen again in the next 10. This is what the prince had to say. He wasn't referring to my house in Michigan, of course. There is a great groundswell of genuine concern about these issues, the issues of environment, which are very much the issues of our day and age. There are many people who are now reacting against those who have held sway for rather too long and who have become completely out of balance with nature. This unbalanced trend in our own time, when we have armored ourselves with such an arsenal of machines and chemicals to do what we like to nature and to reshape the world, has led us to see ourselves as somehow separate from and superior to nature. However, there is a major change in attitude taking place, a growing realization that we are not separate from nature, a subconscious feeling that we need to restore a feeling of harmony with nature and a proper sense of respect and awe for the great mystery and natural order of the universe as we see it and indeed sense it on this earth. Many people are now aware of the problems and dangers of the possibility of catastrophic climatic changes through air pollution, of the mass extinction of species threatened by the loss of tropical forests and other essential habitats. When we read that over the next 60 years, if we go on as we are doing, something like a third of all forms of life at present living on this planet may be extinct, can we feel anything but a kind of cosmic horror? This may sound, said the prince, like alarmism on a hysterical plane, but there is mounting evidence of a gigantic problem that won't go away. And 26 years later, I think the evidence is even more substantial. This kind of forthright prophecy is there throughout these texts, and uncomfortable it may be, outspoken it may be, but it is worthy of attention and is proving to be right. Another aspect of his work has been directly related to climate change. Right at the very beginning in 1992, before the first of the now famous United Nations conferences on environment and development, I don't know if you follow them, but if you do, it is deeply concerning that we are taking so long and making so little progress, and the inertia in our system to responding to these great problems is, to say the least, very disappointing. Governments have prevaricated, but the prince has continued to speak out. And in 2012, at Rio Plus 20, he gave this video message. He said, "I have watched in despair at how slow progress has sometimes been and how the outright skeptical reluctance by some to engage with the critical issues of our day have often slowed that progress to a standstill. Gone are the days, I'm afraid, when we can somehow imagine that the situation is not as bad as our scientists say it will be, nor that the consequences are so far off in the future that we need not worry. One thing is clear, we need to be much more informed about the actual state of our planet. Until we do, we expose ourselves to the mounting danger of many shifts in policy that are not well conceived, but come as panicked responses to crises that could have been avoided." He goes on to speak of the links between environment, society, and economy. And I've quoted these at length. I shan't do for the rest of the archive because this is such an important subject, and I know many of you are concerned with these matters. The other area which the prince is perhaps very well known for his being outspoken about is architecture. You can imagine if you're a very high up architect with a prosperous practice, having great influence over the built environment, it's not much fun being criticized by the Prince of Wales. You may feel that you're beyond criticism if you're a very important high up architect, but he has spoken out. Not especially about particular forms of design, but about what he sees as a falling away from principles of proportion and balance. Sometimes he refers to this as a grammar of architecture. And most importantly, and this is not often reported, he actually speaks more often not about architecture, but what something he calls community planning, which is about the opportunity that local people have to have a say in what happens to the development of their own township or local area. And he was particularly vociferous at the time in the mid-80s of the inner city riots which we had in the United Kingdom, particularly in places like Liverpool, where he felt that local people were enraged at what was happening to their locality, and that the forms of development that were being proposed, which were to rip down areas of houses and put up large towers, disrupted the community, left them abandoned, really. And of course, what have we found? These towers are now being pulled down because in the end, they weren't fit for places. It was not an architecture built to a human scale. It wasn't an architecture built in a dialogue with the families and the people who lived there. It was built by people who thought they knew best, but of course they didn't live there. And this is where the prince has been so courageous to speak out for these communities and try to find ways of enabling them to have a voice. It doesn't make you popular, but he is right in this. There are then two other parts of the archive are on education and medicine and healthcare. I'm not going to say anything about those. And then there's quite a long part on society, religion, and tradition. I do just want to say something about this, because one of the best known speeches of the Prince of Wales is the speech made in 1993 at the Oxford Islamic Center. It was entitled Islam and the West. And His Royal Highness has visited the Arab world on many occasions and is particularly well informed about its history and culture and its ways of being. And it was a speech which was given 8 years before the horrors of 9/11. Since that speech, the risks that he spoke of have come to haunt us and to dominate much of our lives. And indeed, 13 years later, in 2006, speaking at the Al-Azhar University in Cairo, he reminded his audience of the tragedy of those intervening years. Years in which his fears had been confirmed, saying, lingering mistrust persists and with dreadful results. And so it is that in these speeches, the prince has argued that we should try and recover the depth, subtlety, and generosity of imagination and respect for wisdom that so marked Islam in its great ages. And he has suggested that we might honor the single most important principle that unites the Abrahamic faiths, that is the golden rule, that we should treat others as we would have them treat us. Of course, he has spoken about other faiths too, all the other faiths, the Hindu, the Sikh traditions, Judaism, and of course, Christianity. But I think one of his major contributions, both in his speeches and his work with young people throughout his charities, is in trying to develop reverence and respect, tolerance and understanding between Islam and the West. These are the thoughts of a man who looks deeply within himself and within the great teachings of which Professor Bushrui is such a scholar. This is a quest for meaning and not just for the short term, but for the long term as well. In 1992, speaking at the Académie des Sciences in Paris, the prince talked of the possibility of a need for a new philosophy of our time. We're looking at, he said, it seems to me, for a new philosophy based not only on seeking a proper balance between the information that is now at our disposal and how we should respond to it, but for the planet we have inherited and are charged with handing on in good repair to our successors. We are talking not of philanthropy or charity, but of hard-nosed, self-interested action by the human race designed to do no less than ensure the future survival of the species. In the process, I hope we shall not forget that the stock of what I will call human wisdom is much the same today as it was in Aristotle's day, and that we neglect at our peril the human and spiritual dimensions of the values and traditions which have been handed down to us over the generations. The final two main parts of the archive are about the Prince's Trust and business in the community. These are two of the largest parts of his work. Prince's Trust, dealing with young people, business in the community, as it suggests, dealing with the relationship between business and community. And these are large charitable enterprises. The Prince's Trust, which started in 1976 when the Prince gave his the money that he got when he left the Navy. It was a princely sum of about £7,460, about $10,000. And he gave it to set up the Prince's Trust. Their budget for this year is somewhere around 90 million. How often do you hear that reported, this great work by this great man, over a long period of time? And the budget for business in the community is over $30 million, sponsoring apprenticeships, encouraging volunteers, helping people in the countryside. It's great work. And it's been a delight for Professor Bushrui and I in some way to honor it in this archive. Now, of course, this evening I've only given you a glimpse of the Prince's work as it's described in the archive. His Royal Highness is, in fact, the patron of 16 major charities. But what I think the archive does show is both the breadth of the Prince's work and the depth and consistency of principle that it represents. These two go hand in hand. This is not the record of someone rushing hither and thither according to their fancy, but rather it is the record of a coherent and developing body of work, deliberately and with enormous effort, put together over a period of more than 40 years. If its range is wide, its principles are clear. Principles of harmony set within a concern with the present, a vision for the future, and a respect for the past. At the end of the archive is an epilogue. It only includes two speeches. The first is a speech given to soldiers and their families at the end of the Gulf War in 1991. And the second is a speech given by the Prince in June 2012 as part of the tribute to his mother, the Queen, on her Diamond Jubilee, in which he famously referred to Her Majesty as Mummy. We included this speech for two reasons. First, because it is the most well-known speech of 2012. And secondly, because in a way it captures the special relationship between of the British people with their monarchy. A subtle mixture of given deference and a wish for familiarity. The speech speaks of duty and of service, and of an essential sense of unity through diversity, which is how we are when we are at our best. This, too, is surely the mark of the work of the Prince, as it is recorded in this archive. For this is the motto of His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales. Ich dien, I serve. Thank you.
And Professor Cadman, on behalf of the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences, we have a gift for you for working so closely and working with Suheil and the Gibran Chair and bringing this work.
Thank you.
Next, I'd like to introduce Professor Suheil Bushrui, and Professor Bushrui really needs no introduction. I could tell by everybody in this room how loved he is by everybody here. And when Professor Cadman said, a great work by a great man, I thought of Professor Bushrui. We all admire his hard work, his dedication. He's well loved by his colleagues and friends all around us here today. So, Professor, I'm handing the mic over to you. Professor.
Thank you very much. Mr. President, thank you very much for bestowing your patronage on this evening. I want to really thank everyone who has spoken. A few days ago, I was between this world and the next. I want to pay tribute to my dear wife. Had it not been for her, I wouldn't be here tonight. Mrs. Bushrui and I have lived together for 60 years. It has been a relationship which I believe should be as the norm and the standard of every marriage. Mrs. Bushrui taught me that women are superior to men. I therefore bow before all women here. Yesterday, I received a phone call. It was a generous gift of money, in which I was asked to use it to our best interest. And I thought, what better way in which this can be invested in some kind of prize to help young women establish those qualities of the spirit that they, as mothers, can appreciate. I therefore tonight want to say that I'm trying to put together tonight a form of scholarship given the name of Mrs. Peri Mithaqi, a lady who has been most generous to us. I also think I'd be remiss if I did not thank the new dean for being here tonight. Dean John Townshend and myself have fought several battles, not against each other, but so that we could bring about something very special to the College of Behavior and Social Sciences. I thank you all for what you have bestowed on this humble servant. But I want to say one thing about David Cadman. He's my teacher. Oh yes, he can bestow all the gifts on me. But in fact, he is the leader. I followed in his footsteps. I followed his instructions. He and I are very close to the prince. And we have, over the years, developed a relationship that is of the spirit. I don't know what I can say. There are a lot of things that I have to share with you. But I want to thank Mr. Subhani for pushing the wheelchair If it were not for him, I wouldn't be here tonight. In hospital, two things were very clear to me. If you are here, do your very best to be there in good shape. And I pray God Almighty to protect you all and to bestow upon every one of you his gifts of the Spirit. And please pray that Mrs. Bushrui will forgive me for all the suffering she went through in the past and today. What shall I say? I want to thank one person who's very close to me, Anne Holmes. Anne Holmes has been the spirit behind everything that made my work possible. And I thank her for that. Please, please, I am going to retire by June of 2015. But I promise one thing, I shall work with the new dean through the blessings of Mr. Zachim, who spoke to me yesterday and said, Suheil, don't worry, I shall continue to support this chair to the very end. So I will be working with the new dean on these issues, and I want to recognize as well my two colleagues, Shibli Talhami, very distinguished scholar, the Sadat Chair for World Peace, and Dr. Huda Mahmoudi, who is the Baha'i Chair for World Peace. There are three peace chairs. Let us hope that this university, as always, under the leadership of our great, great president, Wallace Low, will bring about peace into the world. I don't know what to say, really. I'm lost for words, but forgive me, and God bless you all.